Okay, welcome to ME3501's Torsion Experiment. And in this experiment, what we're going to be doing is we're going to take some solid cylindrical specimens. So these are actually hexagonal cross-section rod that has been lathed down to a solid cylindrical section. And we're going to make measurements of the initial cross-section and length of the specimen. So the initial length of the specimen is from machine fillet to machine fillet. And the cross-section is obviously the diameter. So we're going to make measurements of those with a dial caliper and provide those measurements to you. And then during the course of the specimen, we have a steel specimen and an aluminum specimen, just like we had in the tension test. And during the course of the experiment, what we're going to do is we're going to take these specimens and mount them in this machine, which has two lathe chucks, three jaw chucks in them. And this is the controller, which you can use to jog the position of the chucks. So this is a coarse jog, which rotates it pretty fast. This is a fine jog, which rotates it a little bit. And so I'm going to align those chucks. And of the two chucks, this side is the fixed side. So it'll slide back and forth until I lock it with this lever. So I can use this to move the chuck back and forth so that I can grab my specimen appropriately. And then you'll notice the load cell is located on this fixed side. This is what's going to be measuring the torque that is applied to the specimen. This is the actuator side of the testing machine. And when we start the test going, this is going to rotate around, putting a torque on the specimen. This is going to measure the torque. That's going to measure the rotation. And we'll have torque twist graphs, which you're going to use as a basis for calculating your shear stress, shear strain graph for these two materials. And let's proceed to do that. So let me mount up. And so first, I'm going to do the steel specimen first and the aluminum specimen next. Now, one interesting thing that happens with torsion is, and you might want to think about why this is, in the tension test, there's fairly limited ductility. The specimen fractures after a while because it pulls apart. And the torsion test for the same materials, you get actually quite a bit more plastic deformation. You might want to think about why that is and how the mode of fracture is different. One of the ways to illustrate that is by taking a pen. Well, we used a black Sharpie, and by putting a straight line on the side of the specimen before you do the test. And then once the test is over, you can see what happened to that straight line. And you'll see that on these specimens, the straight line wraps around a number of times on some of the specimens. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this aluminum specimen over here, and I'm going to mount it in the machine. So I'm going to align the jaws so that they're gripping the same hex faces. And just the eyeball alignment is good enough. Okay, so I'm going to move this back. And then I'm going to tighten these jaws using the clamp here. And now I'll slide this forward. And as I'm sliding it forward, I'm going to do a more careful job of aligning the facets to the sides of the jaw. So as I slide this forward, I'm going to start tightening this side. I actually did a pretty good job of alignment. Those facets are right on where they're supposed to be. So I'll tighten this up now. And now we're ready to run our experiment. And so we're going to come over here. We're going to click on the specimen properties. We're going to put in the gauge length of the specimen and the material for the specimen. So that's good. Okay, and then I'm going to zero the angle, so the angle of twist starts from zero. And then we're going to run our experiment. And as we run the experiment, what you'll see is on this axis, you'll see torque in foot-pounds. On this axis, you'll see angle in degrees. And that's the data that you're going to get in your Excel spreadsheet. You're going to get torque in foot-pounds and angle in degrees. And you're going to want to convert that to shear stress versus shear strain. One common source of error in this lab is that people forget that the equations that you have in strength of materials, which give you the relationships between torque and twist, all assume that your torque is in radians. So you got to convert your angles from degrees to radians before you do the conversion to shear stress and shear strain. So now we're going to run the experiment. And there you can see the torque went up until the specimen yielded. This is the twist angle continuing to go up linearly. And if you notice over there, that chuck is going round and around and around. We are already to a twist angle of 250 degrees and it's still going. 300 degrees and it's still going. And we'll know the point at which the specimen has failed by when the torque drops, which is right now. You notice the torque suddenly dropped down. That's where you have torsional fracture. And that happened at about, 425 degrees or so. So at this point, I'm going to unload the specimen by undoing the jaws. And then backing off the chuck over here. And then I'm going to jog this one back to the home position. Actually, let's go back to the home position. It's going all the way back around. And then I'll undo this jaw. And you'll see some really cool stuff here. Okay, first of all, you notice this used to be a straight black line, and you notice the helix going all the way around the specimen. Secondly, you notice the shear fracture over here. You can see the discontinuity in the straight line where there's a shear fracture. Also, you notice the cross section of the specimen does not change where it fractures, because this is a shear mode of failure rather than a tensile mode. So think about the implications of that for why this specimen has got so much ductility as compared to the tensile specimen. So if you wanted to actually take a look at the fracture, so this is mostly fractured through at this point, but not completely. There's a little remaining ligament over there. If you wanted to actually take a look at that fracture surface, after you save your data, you can continue to twist it until it twists clean off. And I'll show you that fracture surface on the steel one. After we save the data, we're going to continue to twist it until it twists all the way off. I'm going to go ahead and put a straight line on the steel one and do the same experiment. And then we'll show you the data, and I'll show you the fracture surface just so that you can see qualitatively how different it looks from the fracture surface on a tensile specimen. Okay, so let's mount our steel specimen. I've scribed it with a Sharpie line as well. So I'm going to put it on this chuck over here and tighten the jaws. And this one should slide right into place since we already did our alignment. I'm going to tighten this one as well. Okay, now I didn't lock this jaw on the first experiment. I am going to lock it on the second experiment. There is an interesting difference between whether you lock this jaw or not, which if you're interested in, you should talk to your instructor about. There's a very subtle difference. If your material is totally isotropic, when you subject it to pure torsion, there is no axial load developed. So whether you lock the jaw or not makes no difference to the experimental results if your material is totally isotropic. If your material has some degree of anisotropy, then when you subject it to torsion, it's possible that it will develop a very small torsional axial load, in which case the end conditions of a free end versus a locked end will be quite different, and you can potentially be measurably different if you have a large degree of anisotropy. In the case of the steel and aluminum materials that we have over here, the materials are virtually perfectly isotropic, so whether you lock this jaw or not really makes almost no difference at all. We'll go ahead and do the locked jaw in this particular case, and then let's run the experiment. Again, I have entered the material data into the computer, and we're just going to run the test now. So let's verify the parameters, and then let's run the test. Okay, and there we go. And again, the torque went up to over here, and now you're yielding. The twist is going to continue. You can see the chuck rotating and rotating, and we'll see how long it goes before it reaches torsional failure. And in this case, I'm going to after it reaches torsional failure, I'm going to continue to twist it until it's clean twisted off so that you can see the fracture surface. So we're at 300 degrees rotation. That's 400 degrees rotation. That's 500 degrees. You notice the torsional shear strain is pretty much dead stable. So it's not going up, it's not going down, it's almost completely flat. And there we finally reached the end of it. That was after 650 or more degrees of rotation, so almost two full rotations of the torsion specimen. And so now what I'm going to do is I'm going to continue to rotate it. There, and you heard that little click? That was when the last little ligament let go. So now when I unload the specimen and remove it, you're going to be able to see the fracture surface. Oh, that's cool. Okay, so first of all, you notice the twist over here? This is something that you might want to consider in your analysis of this experiment. The scribed line that I put was straight. But if you notice, the rotation here is concentrated almost all over here. Now, why did that happen? Probably because we have a smaller diameter over here. The specimen wasn't turned down completely evenly, so the deformation focused in the area which had the smaller cross-section. And then now if I break this thing off, you can see the torsional cross-section over there. And you can see that the torsional fracture is almost completely flat, except for that last remaining little ligament where I twisted it off, where you see some little teeth from the shear failure. But the majority of the torsional fracture over the central area of the specimen is completely flat because it was twisting against each other like that. So that's a cool experiment. We'll give you the data for that one. Good luck analyzing it. This is not a good specimen. We should redo it. And there we go. And once again, the specimen has already yielded. So this was the elastic portion of the torque. And then you reached yield, and now it's continuing to deform plastically. And you notice the torque doesn't increase or decrease very much at all. It's continuing to deform in torsion at nearly constant torque. And we have already gone through 300 degrees of rotation. If you notice, that chuck is just spinning round and around. And it's going to go quite a bit further before it breaks. So that's 500 degrees of rotation and still going. We've gone 800 degrees, so that's more than two full revolutions, and the specimen is continuing to go. Okay, so we went a total of 1,200 degrees before the specimen fractured. And at this point, I'm going to continue the rotation so that we can take a look at the fracture surface. And then I'm going to extract the specimen. So let's continue the rotation. Okay, let's bring out the specimen. Okay, so just so that you can see, this black line used to be a straight line. You can see the helical revolutions around the specimen. So that thing twisted a long way before it fractured. And you'll notice the fracture is nearly completely flat except for the edges. And that edge, the kind of teeth that you see on the edge, that was the last little ligament that was still there when I finally turned the specimen. The center of the specimen, which was the basic torsional fracture, was almost completely flat. But then you get a little teeth around the edge of it as well. So there's your torsional fracture. You notice that the cross section of the specimen doesn't change in torsional fracture the way that it does in tensile fracture. And you might want to think about what that means about the different modes of fracture, and that might inform your discussion about why it is that it was so much more ductile in torsion than it was in tension. Good luck analyzing the experiment.